Ladies and gentlemen, welcome once again to the National Press Club for our second Westpac address this week. While Anzac Day marked the centenary of the Anzac landing at Gallipoli, today, August the 6th, marks the 100th anniversary of the August offensive at Gallipoli, the important August offensive. Later today, a commemorative service will be held at Long Pines Cemetery to mark the occasion and honour those who died at Lone Pine and the ensuing bloody battles, which culminated in the final assault on Hill 60, the final major assault of the Gallipoli campaign later that month. Now, our guest today, as you all know, has had a distinguished career in public life. He first came to public notice, actually, as the Vice President of the Australian Medical Association, which is when he first addressed the club back in 1991. He subsequently became President of that organisation, moved into politics, became Minister for Defence, Minister for Education, Leader of the Opposition for a period, and finally, of course, a distinguished career as a diplomat, among other things, as representing Australia at NATO. Now, today, of course, he's here in his current role as the Director of the Australian War Memorial, and he's here to tell us the story of that last throw of the dice at Gallipoli back in August of that year. Would you please welcome Dr. Brendan Nelson.
Thank you very much, Laurie, and I thank the club also for allowing me to come and speak here today and to have the privilege of not only speaking here, but more importantly, to speak about this topic of the August offensive. I recognise many friends that are here, but particularly my friend and mentor, Dr. Bruce Shepherd, without whose support over a long period of time, I would not be here in this role, let alone any of the others that I've done. I've also done something a bit unusual today out of respect for the topic, and that is that I have actually written a speech. I know some of you sort of look forward to me coming and just talking, and my mother certainly does. But on this occasion, I think it's important that we leave a footprint for such an important and seminal event in our nation's not only military, but indeed its history. With a sense of awkward humility, abiding reverence and infused with overwhelming pride, 128,000 Australians paused in the pre-dawn darkness on Anzac Day this year at the Australian War Memorial, joining several million Australians at the cenotaphs, the memorials and the places of commemoration throughout this country and throughout the world. We did so as free and confident heirs to a legacy born of idealism, forged in bloody self-sacrifice and passed now to our generation. Though we didn't say it in so many words, we come together on that occasion and on similar ones in renewed commitment to one another, our nation and the ideals of mankind. Charles Bean was Australia's official First World War historian. He landed with the troops at Gallipoli on the 25th of April 1915. He stayed with them at the front through the entire war. He was wounded in the August offensive, refused to be evacuated, and was witness to it all. It was said of Bean that no one risked death more often than him. He would then, over almost a quarter of a century, write and edit the 12 volumes of the official history. And finally, in searching for the words to type onto the blank page before him, to summarise it all, he wrote this: "What these men did, nothing can alter now. The good and the bad, the greatness and the smallness of their story, it rises, it always rises, above the mists of ages, a monument to great-hearted men, and for their nation a possession forever." The great 19th century English philosopher, John Stuart Mill, one of the pioneers of true liberal thought, concluded that two things are essential for the existence and sustenance of a nation. The first, he said, was that people would want to be governed as one, to be governed as a single nation. And so it was over a generation and a half in the late 19th century. Our forebears resolved that we would become a nation. The legal architecture for the Commonwealth of Australia was born in 1901, and 2 years later we got a flag. Mill's essential second precondition was what he described as a common fellow feeling. One, he said, that is deeply rooted in language and literature and history. Beyond this nation's rich millennia of rich Indigenous history, the devastating impact upon it of the arrival of the First Fleet in 1788, but from it and the pioneers who joined them through the 19th century, the origins of the Australia that we now have. It was not until this cataclysm that unfolded in late 1914 that we got our story. Australia had to form the Australian Imperial Force, for which General Sir William Throsby Bridges is owed a great debt. We sent Australians overseas in an Australian uniform with an Australian flag. Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islanders living in a desperately unequal Australia, and though prohibited from doing so, only 4 to 5 generations after the arrival of the First Fleet, enlisted to fight for the young nation. In doing so, they found equality in the AIF. There was no black or white, only shades of grey. A series of largely catastrophic military battles ensued until the stunning leadership of General Sir John Monash of the Australian Corps in 1918. Australia has never been more divided than it was during the period of the First World War, principally but not only around the conscription referenda. Whether Tasmanians, Victorians or Western Australians, people look to the federal government increasingly for answers to questions that could not be answered. From a nation of 4.5 million people in 1914, 1 million men were of an age that could volunteer. And of those, 417,000 did. We sent 330,000 overseas, and 4 years later, almost 62,000 dead. Another 60,000 would die within 10 years of returning to Australia. Such was the impact on our young nation. We emerged from the war proud at what had been achieved, but a generation inconsolably mourning its dead and dying. Though public discourse was deeply embittered, we remained true to our democratic principles, of which our generation should be so immensely proud. Every nation has its story. This is our story. There is no more powerful or poignant chapter to that story than the August Offensive 100 years ago. By early August, 3 months after the landing, a stalemate enveloped the Gallipoli Peninsula. The Anzacs were contained within a 160-hectare beachhead. British Commander General Ian Hamilton wanted an all-out attempt to break the deadlock. An outbreak was conceived and planned to seize the high ground north of the Anzac sector. It would be the largest and most costly of the Gallipoli campaign, the last throw of the dice. A complex series of offensive attacks requiring precise timings were planned, involving British, Australian, New Zealand, and Indian troops. All would end in heartbreaking failure. Success depended on the Allies seizing 3 high points: Hill 971, Hill Q, and Chunuk Bair. Bird would fail to appreciate the rugged, twisted, folded terrain. He also ignored the poor physical condition of troops, worn down by constant artillery fire and fly-borne diseases spread from dead corpses. Even had the Allied commander's actions and questionable tactics succeeded, there would still be many more ridges before reaching the Killard Bar Plateau overlooking the Dardanelles. On the evening of the 6th of August, 2 columns of Allied troops headed for key features on the Sari Bear Range, Hill Q and Hill 971. The objective was to advance to the hills to the north and, as Peter Burness has reminded us, link in a pincer with the light horse assaults at dawn the next day. The Australian attack on Lone Pine was to be a distraction for the Ottoman forces, to draw away potential reinforcements into other battles. At the same time, 20,000 British troops in five divisions started landing at Suvla Bay, 8 kilometres to the north. Simultaneously, the New Zealand and mounted brigades began their advance to Chunuk Bair, one of the highest points of the Sari Bair Ridge. They were to capture it in support of the dawn attack by the Australian Light Horse in the dawn of the 7th of August at the Neck. The depleted 6th Battalion was to take out the enfilading machine guns at German officers' trench at midnight, essential to the success of attacks the following morning. They failed. The first Light Horse attacked at Pope's Hill. Of the 200 in the attack, 154 were killed or wounded. At Quinn's Post, Major George Bourne stopped the attack when most of his men of the 2nd Light Horse were killed in the first wave. New Zealand's finest moment at Gallipoli was also its most costly. 900 men died at Chunuk Bair. The undermanned New Zealand Mounted Brigade suffered 100 casualties, capturing the outposts. By 4:30 a.m., three of the four New Zealand battalions had reached the apex, 400 metres below the summit. The Canterburys were lost on the southern side of the spur. Brigadier General Francis Johnson, who was described as ill but fighting drunk that day, made the final decision and the fateful decision to halt the attack at the apex and to wait for the Canterburys. In doing so, he further sealed the fate of the Australian Light Horse, third Light Horse, who were about to attack at the Neck into withering Turkish machine gun fire. Johnson's delay gave the Turks time to be reinforced. Johnson ordered the Auckland Battalion to attack into fierce rifle and machine gun fire. Of the 400 who attacked, only 100 reached the pinnacle. Finally, after a naval bombardment and followed by two British battalions, the Wellingtons reached the summit, almost unopposed at 3 a.m. on the 8th of August. The Turks counterattacked and fought desperately all day. The dead New Zealanders clogged the trenches. By evening, when the British relieved the Kiwis, only 49 of the 760 Wellingtons who attacked that morning were able to walk off the hill unaided. Corporal Cyril Bassett was awarded the Victoria Cross for keeping communication and phone lines open under intense fire. On the 10th of August, Kemal Ataturk launched a heavy counterattack, annihilating Chunuk Bair's British defenders. As the British fled the pinnacle, pursued by the Turks, the New Zealand machine gunners restored order at the apex, firing into the surging humanity. Almost 100 years ago to the hour, the Australians attacked at Lone Pine in a battle of epic, senseless savagery. At its end, 4 days later, would be 2,300 Australian casualties, almost 7,000 Turkish casualties, and seven Australians would be awarded the Victoria Cross, two of them posthumously. Lone Pine was a frontal assault over 100 metres, but the fighting and the dying was by bayonets and bombs in the Turkish trenches, galleries and tunnels. The network of Turkish trenches at Lone Pine constituted the strongest part of the Turkish front in the Anzac area. At the southern edge of the feature known as 400 Plateau, from its height above sea level, the ground was bitterly contested and changed hands repeatedly shortly after the landing. A single stunted pine tree grew there, so the Australians had called it the Lonesome Pine, from a popular show song of the day. To the Turks, it was simply Canlisset or Bloody Ridge after their heavy losses from the 19th May attacks. By early August, the Turkish trenches at Lone Pine were protected by barbed wire, but a heavy overhead cover of pine logs and earth. No man's land between the Turkish and Australian front lines was relatively wide, and the Australian line formed a salient around a feature known as the pimple. The original lone pine tree was long gone. Brigadier General Harold, or Hookie as he was known, Walker, commanded the 1st Australian Division. He had serious reservations about a frontal assault in broad daylight over open ground. The Turks held the hill which dominated Lone Pine, Baby 700, and as such, Hookie Walker wanted it taken out first and to use a full division for the task. Birdwood wouldn't hear of it, insisting that the continuous pressure on the Turks of fighting at Lone Pine must, and I quote, help the attack elsewhere. The 2nd, 3rd and 4th battalions took their position in the trenches. They'd sewn white patches onto their backs and wore white armbands. The artillery bombardment stopped at 5:30 p.m. and the whistles blew. Most charged across open ground. Others emerged from the tunnels into no man's land. It was over in a minute. The Australians had to fight through the pine logs and the earth that was covering the Turkish trenches. And by 6 p.m, the main trench network was captured and cleared. In a corner of one trench, 8 Turks and 6 Australians lay enjoined, having bayoneted each other. 8 isolated defensive posts were established in broken trenches at the centre, and the long Turkish communication trenches were blocked with sandbags. Sergeant Lawrence, the Australian tunnelling engineer, stood on the captured main Turkish trench and looked back to the Australian lines from whence they'd come, and he described the carnage. All the way across is just one mass of dead bodies. Beside me, I count 14 of our boys stone dead. It is a piteous sight. Men and boys who yesterday were full of joy and life, now lying there cold, lifeless. Glassy eyes, sallow, dusty faces. Soulless, somebody's son, somebody's boy. The major standing next to me says, well, we have won. My God, that means a victory. And all these bodies within arm's reach, then may I never see a defeat. The worst was yet to come. The Turks counterattacked the next day. Bullets, bayonets, bombs, clubs, fists, teeth, feet were the weaponry used in this most intense battle of subterranean anarchy of the entire war. Private Cecil McNulty of the 2nd Battalion recorded a diary of sorts on bits of paper, backs of envelopes. And he wrote this. Frank and I were on the extreme left. There was a clear space of 100 yards to cross without a patch of cover. I can't realise how I got across it. I seemed to be in a sort of trance. The rifle and machine gun fire was hellish. I remember dropping down when we reached the trenches, looked around and saw Frank and 3 men alongside me. I yelled out to the other 4 chaps, this is only suicide, boys. I'm going to make a jump for it. I thought they said, all right, we'll follow. I sprang to my feet in one jump. The diary stops dead at that point. McAnulty died at Lone Pine, sometime between the 7th and the 12th of August. Private John Gammage of the 1st Battalion wrote this. The moans of our own poor fellows and also Turks as we tramped on their wounded bodies was awful. The wounded bodies of both our Turks and our own were piled up 3 and 4 deep. The bombs simply poured in. But as fast as our men went down, another would take his place. We had no time to think of our wounded. Their pleas for mercy were not heeded. Some poor fellows lay for 30 hours waiting for help, and many died still waiting. 1,000 corpses were dragged from the Australian trenches for burial. Many more were left to rot in the captured Turkish trenches as the Australians prepared to defend against an expected counterattack. An incident just before the assault on Lone Pine, observed and recorded by Charles Bean, perhaps says it best. He observed an Australian soldier going from one trench to the next at the very front of the Australian line. And he leaned over one of them to the men in it. He asked, "Jim here?" And a voice came back from the fire step, "Yeah, right here, Bill." "Do you blokes mind moving up a piece?" asked the first voice. "Him and me are mates, and we're going over together." The first Allies returned to Gallipoli in December 1918 and said of the plateau around Lone Pine this: "Lone Pine was covered with a thin, scattered whiteness, not unlike the sprinkle of melting snow. Over the former trenches lay the bare white bones, piled or clustered so thickly in places that we had to tread upon them as we passed." One name inscribed in the Lone Pine Memorial is that of Private Mark Smith of the 4th Battalion, killed at Lone Pine. He was 21 years old. Benjamin Smith had gone into the attack with the 3rd Battalion. Having heard of his brother's death, he spent 3 days trying to find Mark's body. He couldn't, but he retrieved a pine cone from a log in the Turkish trenches and sent it back to their mother, Mrs. McMullen. From it, she grew a seedling, which she sent to the Yarralumla nursery in 1929. Every 6 months, she would write to John Trelaw, the first director of the memorial, and she would ask of the status of her son's tree. In 1934, when only the foundations of the Australian War Memorial had been laid, Trelaw invited the Duke of Gloucester to ceremonially plant that sapling. Today it is the magnificent Lone Pine tree on the grounds of the Australian War Memorial that honours one Australian son, but honours them all. At the Neck on the 7th of August, the day after the commencement of the attack at Lone Pine, further extraordinary courage was shown by the men of the 8th and the 10th Regiments of the 3rd Light Horse Brigade. The Neck was a vitally important position. It was on the northern end of the Anzac sector. It was a narrow bridge of land that stretched from Russell's Top and Baby 700. And it was important because from it, the Turks could see what was going on the beach and the military movements being undertaken by the Anzacs. It was important for the Australians because it was the key to Chunuk Bair. The attack was to begin at 4:30 a.m. on the 7th of August in four waves, 150 men in each wave. The distance to advance was just 20 to 60 metres. It would be preceded by a bombardment of the Turkish trenches. However, the bulk of the shells went over the Turkish lines, beyond their intended targets, and ended 7 minutes early. But the Light Horse officers held their men back until the appointed time for the attack. And in that eerie silence, they could hear the Turks cocking their rifles and testing their machine guns. Lieutenant Colonel Alexander Henry White was 33 years old. He was a maltster from Ballarat. He elected to lead the men of the 8th Light Horse, whom he loved. The Age correspondent, Philip Schuller, observed him making a brief farewell to his brother officers, shaking each of them by the hand. He then stepped into the trench and stood in the firing line, waiting, watch in hand. "Men," he said, "you have 10 minutes to live and I will lead you." When the time came, the whole line went. White had not gone 10 paces when he fell dead. The first wave from the 8th Light Horse was shot to pieces, as was the second. Of the 300 officers and men under White's command, 153 died with him. Another 80 were wounded. Officers suggested cancelling the attack. Lieutenant Colonel Noel Brazier, commanding the 10th Light Horse, pleaded that it be so. But it was overruled by Major John Antle of the 3rd Light Horse Brigade, who simply shouted, "Push on." The Western Australians of the 10th Light Horse Regiment formed the 3rd and 4th assaulting waves. The men filing into the trench for the 3rd wave took a last look at photographs of wives and loved ones, removed wedding rings and personal keepsakes, and attached them to the inside of the trench. Trooper Rush turned and embraced the man next to him with the words that would become the epitaph for his grave at Walker's Ridge Cemetery. "Goodbye, Cobber. God bless you." He was 23 years old. When the whistle blew, all jumped over the parapet with a cry. Gresley and Wilfred Harper were from Guildford, Western Australia. Both had gone to Perth to enlist immediately after the declaration of war and were given consecutive enlistment numbers, 113, 114, and they went into the 10th Light Horse. Their bodies were later seen on the parapet of the front Turkish trench. Gresley was 31 and Wilfred 25 years old. Charles Bean wrote, "Wilfred was last seen running forward like a schoolboy in a foot race with all the speed he could compass." Of the 600 who went over the top, the 3rd Light Horse suffered 372 casualties. The bodies were piled two and three deep in an area the size of two tennis courts. Sergeant Cliff St. Pinnock miraculously survived the first wave of the 8th Light Horse, and he wrote to his parents a week later. "Roll call was the saddest. 47 of 550 answered the call. When I heard the result, I cried like a baby." Bean summarised the bravery of these men and the cost thus. The 10th Light Horse Regiment went forward to meet death instantly, as the 8th had done, the men running as swiftly and as straight as they could at the Turkish rifles. With that regiment went the flower of the youth of Western Australia, sons of the old pioneering families, youngsters, in some cases two or three from the same home, who'd flocked to Perth at the outbreak of war with their own horses and saddlery in order to secure enlistment in a mounted regiment of the AIF. Men known and popular, the best-loved leaders in sport and work in the West, they rushed straight to their death. Bean would later write, "In the history of war, there is no more signal example of reckless obedience than that given by the dismounted light horsemen at the Neck, when after seeing the whole first attacking line mown down within a few yards by the whirlwind of rifle and machine gun fire, the second, third and fourth lines each changed after its interval of time at the signal of its leaders to certain destruction." Private Victor Nicholson saw his best mate Lofty killed at Quinn's Post in the August offensive, shot through the eye looking through a peephole. And he wrote, "I didn't cry unless Gallipoli was one long cry. If you started crying once, you'd never stop. There were friends going every day, and sometimes every hour of the day. Wonderful friends. I cried inwardly. That's all you could do." Better than anyone, Private Henry Alcock of the 23rd Battalion summed up the entire offensive end in late August with a letter home to his parents. He wrote, "The Turks are only 15 yards away, and in some places only a sandbag separates them from us. We often throw notes over to one another, and once the Turk threw a note back over saying, 'You are too weak to advance and too strong to retire, and we are the same. So what the hell are we going to do about it?' Another one said, If you don't surrender in 24 hours, we will. At 11:44 p.m. this last Tuesday night, on the 4th of August, seven letters, a metre high, were projected onto the front of the Australian War Memorial on the horizontal beam immediately beneath the Byzantine-inspired dome above the Hall of Memory. And they read one single name, White, W-H-I-T-E, A-H, Alexander Henry White. His name, along with the names of almost the 62,000 of them, is being projected for 30 seconds on 30 occasions over the centenary period of the First World War. It is being projected for two reasons. The first is to ensure that we don't fall into the temptation, human beings that we are, to settle for the broad brushstrokes, to settle for the headlines of our history, in neglectful ignorance to allow that history to become a distant stranger, that we do not ever forget the individual sacrifices made in our name, devotion to duty and devotion to our country. The second reason is to remind us that in the end, there are some truths by which we live, and they're worth fighting to defend, politically, diplomatically, and at times, militarily. This is our history, but it's got much more to do with our future. We are Australians not only or so much because we have a constitution and the machinery of a democracy given to us by the British. We're defined most by our values and our beliefs, the way we relate to one another and see our place in the world. We are shaped by our triumphs and our failures, our heroes and our villains, the way as a people we've faced adversity, and as a nation how we face the adversities and the emerging horizons before us. As the world moves, as I believe it is at the moment, from one age to another, as the tectonic plates shift with the re-emergence of China, and as we face a generational struggle against resurgent totalitarianism in the form of Islamic extremism, we must be clear about who we are and in what we believe. Until his death, leading his men at the neck, Alexander White carried with him two precious items. He wore a locket within which was a photograph of his wife Myrtle and his infant son, young Bill. He also carried in his Bible a poem that he had cut from a newspaper. Let me be a little braver when temptation bids me waver. Let me strive a little harder to be all that I should be. Let me be a little meeker with the brother that is weaker. Let me think more of my neighbour and a little less of me. The Hall of Memory at the Australian War Memorial, within which since 1993 has been interred the unknown Australian soldier, has standing as silent sentinels above him 15 stained glass windows. Each depicts a serviceman and nurse of the First World War, and at the base of each one of them is a single word. Charles Bean, John Trelaw, a veteran himself of the Gallipoli campaign and effectively first director of the memorial, with the army historian, sat down and set themselves a challenge. They asked themselves, what are the virtues? What are the qualities that we saw in these men and women as nurses we regard as being essential, not just for victory in battle, but for depth and breadth of character? Character, of course, coming from the Greek word, meaning the impression left in wax by a stone ring. And those 15 qualities that they chose, resource, candour. And the most central one, a nation reveals itself in certain subtle but powerful ways. The most central image they chose was that of a nurse, not a light horseman or a naval officer, a nurse. And the quality beneath it is devotion, to completely subsume yourself in the cause and the people to which you are committed. Curiosity, independence, comradeship, ancestry, patriotism, chivalry, loyalty, coolness, control, audacity, endurance, and decision. A century after the August offensive, young Australians looking for values for the world they want, as distinct from the one they think they're going to get, need look no further than those values. The world loves talent, but it pays off on character. At our invitation, the Scottish archaeologist and historian Neil Oliver arrived in the spring of 2013 to record a behind-the-scenes documentary for Foxtel's History Channel. In the opening scene of the very first episode, Oliver walks up the steps of the Australian War Memorial, and to camera he says this: "It is always daunting when you arrive in a new place as an outsider and try to find the locations and stories to tell. Well, it's infinitely more challenging when you arrive at a nation's emotional and spiritual centre, its beating heart, and while there, try to find the words to do that place justice." 16 months later, having read the diaries and the letters, the stories behind the artefacts, the relics, having witnessed the reconstruction of the magnificent and stunning First World War galleries, in the few minutes of the very last episode, he stood in the twilight darkness in the commemorative area, just down the steps from the Hall of Memory, next to the Flame of Remembrance, and he said this: "Look closer. There is more here than war. Between 1914 and 1918, we made for ourselves the worst times and places imaginable. And yet even in such places, surrounded by horror and fear, these men devoted their last moments not to themselves, but to one another. And that's love. The love might not survive them, but it was the last thing they would lose. The realisation that in such places, love between friends and for friends was there at its end is beautiful. And so, as well as all the death, loss and horror, it is friendship and love that will be remembered here and for all time." At Pozzi, Air France in 1916, Australia sustained 23,000 casualties in 3 weeks. And it was there in late July, witness to it all, that Charles Bean recorded this. "Many a man lying out there at Pozzi, and in the low scrub at Gallipoli, with his poor, tired senses barely working through the fever of his brain, has thought in his last moments, well, it's over. But in Australia, they will be proud of this." We are. We are damned proud. We are proud of what they gave us. Belief in ourselves and the gift of knowing that ultimately a life of value is one spent in the service of others and our nation. That sentiment of Alexander White's poem, "Let me think more of my neighbour and a little less of me," is what most strengthens and sustains the most fragile yet powerful of human emotions, hope. Like them, what we need most is one another. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Nelson. It's not particularly fashionable in journalism these days, but one of the things in this role I try to avoid is making subjective comments. But on this occasion, I'm going to say that was one of the best, most important, powerful speeches that I've heard delivered at this club. and one that I would hope every Australian has a chance to hear or read at some stage. So thank you very much for that.